Good afternoon and welcome to this worship service, this time to celebrate the life of Debbie Perry. My name is Renee Rico. I'm the transitional pastor here, and it is our privilege to host this service for Debbie today, who is a much beloved member, and we are glad that you are here. We invite you to greet the family after the service. We will have them exit first so that they can be out there to greet you. And if you're looking for a bathroom after the service, you just go down the little hallway and go to your left, and you'll see a men and women's restroom there. But again, welcome. As we enter into worship, I invite you to read responsively with me our call to worship printed in your bulletin. God is our refuge and strength, a very present help in trouble.
Therefore,
as a father has compassion for his children, so the Lord has compassion for those who fear God. I will live, and everyone and believes in me will never die. Let us pray. Eternal God, your love for us is everlasting. You alone can turn the shadow of death into the brightness of the morning light. Help us to turn to you with believing hearts. In the stillness of this hour, speak to us of eternal things, so that hearing the promises in Scripture, we may have hope and be lifted above our distress into the peace of your presence through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Amen. I invite you to now stand as you are able, and we will be singing Just a Closer Walk with Thee. We're going to be singing the refrain once at the beginning, and then each verse. We're not going to do the refrains in between. Number 835. You may be seated. The prelude we heard as the service began was picked by Beth because it was a wonderful song, a wonderful piece, piano piece, played really ably by Janice Wheat, that she shared with her mom, and it just helped her relax. And so I hope as we have gathered here today, we are finding that centered space with God. And so let us pray. Holy One, you are gathered, we gather here to hear your word. And so as we hear these scriptures, may they help us live into the abundant life that you have promised us. Amen. Now we have two scripture lessons today, one from Psalm 91 and one from the Gospel of John in the New Testament. I looked at Psalm 91 and the scriptures we picked, and those are the key scriptures, and I'll note them as I read it. But I think the whole psalm really expresses the faith that Debbie had in God. And so I'm going to read the whole psalm and listen for its message. You who live in the shelter of the Most High, who abide in the shadow of the Almighty, will say to the Lord, my refuge and my fortress, my God in whom I trust. For he will deliver you from the snare of the fowler and from the deadly pestilence. He will cover you with his pinions, and under his wings you will find refuge. His faithfulness is a shield and buckler. You will not fear the terror of the night, or the arrow that flies by day, or the pestilence that stalks in darkness, or the destruction that wastes at noonday. 1,000 may fall at your side, 10,000 at your right hand, but it will not come near you. You will only look with your eyes and see the punishment of the wicked. Because you have made the Lord your refuge, the Most High your dwelling place, no evil shall befall you, no scourge come near your tent. And here are the key verses. For he will command his angels concerning you to guard you in all your ways. On their hands they will bear you up so that you will not dash your foot against a stone. And the psalm finishes this way. You will tread on the lion and the adder, the young lion and the serpent you will trample underfoot. Those who love me I will deliver. I will protect those who know my name. When they call to me, I will answer them. I will be with them in trouble. I will rescue them and honor them. With long life, I will satisfy them and show them my salvation. Holy wisdom, holy word, thanks be to God. We're going to begin with memories from the family of Debbie. And so, Joe, are you going first today?
Well, I want to thank everyone for coming for the celebration of Debbie's life and her ascension. Come on now. There we go. Isaiah 40:31. They, the Lord, shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with angels as in with wings of eagles. There's an poem, unknown author. It's called Angel's Whisper. An angel whispered in her ear, it's time to come, my dear. Your spirit is gentle, kind, and free. I need someone like you by me. Someone with your beautiful smile, I'll hold your hand and wipe your tears. I will take away all your fears. God called you home, I don't know why. I don't know why you had to die. But he loves you more than words can say. Follow me, I'll show you the way. With Debbie's life, it all started with God. About 71 years ago, God says, we got a problem here. We're going to need an angel. And so he sent Bruce and Ruth Barth a little angel. And they called her Deborah Ray. And she grew. And after about 20 years, he introduced her to the problem. But then he said, it's not time yet. So he waited another 3 years, and then he says, here's your problem. Good luck, you're going to need it. And we were married. Now, it didn't take too long into the marriage before I realized that I had a problem. I didn't know it was a problem, but I had a problem. Debbie was stronger than I was mentally, emotionally, and spiritually. It was really kind of strange to be like that. But over time, with patience and guiding by her, I kind of came around. I'm assuming, since God called her home, that her work was done. I hope it was done successfully. But I feel very blessed. Come Monday, we would have had 47 years together. You know, but I had some wonderful years. We had good times, bad times, trouble times, you know, just like anybody else. But looking back on them, we were together, and it was wonderful. I wouldn't change it for anything. I really believe that Debbie was an angel in the flesh. And also, I don't really feel sadness for me. I do miss her, but I'm not sad for me. I am sad for my kids and our grandchildren, because they're not going to have her loving arms to wrap around them, to hug them, and to talk to her, and to have her teach them. She's wonderful. But with that being said, I also know that since she is an angel, that she will be watching over them and helping to guide them and instruct them as they grow. Debbie really didn't like angels all that much. We only have, 17 figurines of angels in the kitchen, 38 angels figurines in the dining room, 60 angels in the living room, and I couldn't count any higher, so I didn't go to the bedrooms. But she was an angel. And there's a statement by an Argentine author, first name Leo, middle initial F, and his last name is B-U-S-C-A-G-L-I-A. I am not going to try to pronounce it. I have been working on it, and it's not coming out. But I really feel strongly with what he says. He says, and I agree with him, I know for certain that we never lose the people we love, even to death. They continue to participate in every act, thought, decision we ever make. Their love leaves an indelible imprint in our memories. We find comfort in knowing that our lives have been enriched by having shared their love. I've got another verse I'd like to recite, and it's Romans 5, 1 and 2. And it's from an indigenous translation of the New Testament, the First Nations version. This good standing we have brings peace to the Great Spirit. The Spirit comes from trusting the Creator set free, Jesus, the Chosen One, and what He has done for us. Our trust in Him opens the way into the Creator's greatness, kindness, and is now solid ground on which we stand. Now our boasting in Him as we look forward to being the kind of people the Great Spirit created us to be, the people filled with beauty and shining greatness. Now, out in the narthex are some ornamental angels that you can put on your Christmas tree or just have in your house. And there are some bookmarks. Take those as in memory of Debbie. Thank you. Forgot, I gotta get back up here. Back. This is my daughter, Ruth, and she has a few words.
Wow, I don't know how to follow that. Where do you start with such an amazing woman? Her name might have been Deborah Rae Barth Perry, but she had so many different titles. To some, she was Deborah. To others, she was Deb or Debbie. Some called her sister. Some called her sister-in-law, daughter, mom, grandma, wife. But to many, she was just a friend. You might have called her one of the other ones, too, but she was a friend to them also. Whatever you called her, she was amazing. And I really didn't get to start seeing a lot of it until she was gone. I knew it, but it didn't really sink in. My mom taught me how to walk, run, ride a bike, climb, talk, sing, dance, dress myself. She taught me how to kind of cook. Still working on that one. Thank goodness I got a great husband that can cook, because my poor kids wouldn't eat otherwise. She taught me how to drive. That was a good time. For me, anyway. She was losing her sight. When you're 15 and your mom's losing her sight, and you learn how to drive, she can't tell you you're wrong. Eventually, she did have it reversed and was able to see. She taught you how to love others. She taught me how to love and trust the Lord. I could go on. The list just keeps going. But when she was gone, she taught me what kind of woman she really was. See, before there were computers and the internet, she kept in contact with friends that she made when she was a little girl. Some of them go back to when she was in first and second grade. She also told me that kindergarten wasn't a thing. So that means in first grade, she was 5, 6 years old. So some of these friendships have stood the test of time. She'd move, update addresses. They'd move, she'd update addresses. Before cell phones, we had landlines. She'd update phone numbers. When I moved out, if I needed a phone number and address, I called her. Hey, Mom, did so-and-so move? Do they have a new phone number, an address? She'd give it to me. Now I'm going to need to do it and make sure that everybody that is on that list, I have addresses for and that I keep in contact with. Because not only were they important to her, that makes them important to me. Next, one thing that Mom could always do was calm you down. Didn't matter how hysterical or crying, sobbing you were, she could understand what you were saying. I don't know how, but she could. And then she could talk you down to where everybody else could then understand you and bring you back down to where they could understand you to what problem you had. And then the problem wasn't a problem anymore because she normally fixed it. A tradition that we had every Christmas when we were growing up, we made cookies. Not just any cookies, we made icing cookies. And they were the best. When we were little, she'd roll them out and we'd get to cut them. She put them on the tray, put them in the oven, then they'd come out. We'd icing them, and I think we got more icing on us than the cookies so we could lick the icing. Of course, it was pure sugar. And as we grew older, we got to help more and more. And then when I got married, moved out and started my own family, I called her for the recipes. She gave them to me over the phone. And my own family started that tradition. We made our Christmas cookies. In the last few years, Mom couldn't make them. So we made them for her, and sent them to her, or brought them down. And I know that she loved them, because it's what we did. Over the last couple weeks, I've realized how much I actually called her for advice that I never really knew. I'd call her and text her a picture and say, "Hey, on me. Does this outfit make me look fat?" I'd call her and say, "How long do I boil eggs again? I don't remember. We need to make and dye the eggs for the Easter Bunny." She could tell me 100 times, and she never, ever got mad about it. I call her and say, "Do you remember what so-and-so needs or what so-and-so wants for Christmas? Or do you think that this grandkid or that grandkid would like this for their birthday or for Christmas?" And we'd scheme and come up with ideas for what she'd get them or what I'd get them. I won't be able to do that this year. She also made what I call Debbie cards. Because if there was an event happening, you were getting a card made by her. She printed them out. She cut them with funky scissors. And, of course, added glitter. The glitter didn't stay in the card. It got everywhere but the card. And you couldn't get it out of anything else. But you got one of her homemade cards for your graduation, your birthday, your anniversary, or just because she was thinking of you. She'd not only do the card, but she'd print out the envelope and put stickers on it. You always knew when you got one of her cards in the mail because it had stickers. You didn't have to look to know who it came from. I know that her and Dad loved each other so much. And with almost 47 years under their belt, not many people make that anymore. I just hope I'm lucky enough to be able to follow in their footsteps with my husband. Since their marriage stood the test of time, they got married. They had the three of us. She opened her heart and had more love for the three of us. Then us three got married, and she added all of our spouses to that love. Then we all started having kids, and we've all got grandkids for her. And her heart just overflowed, and she couldn't have been happier because she loved those kids. She spent as much time as she could with them. If she could take them for the summer, she would. I know that my kids came down at least for 3 weeks in the summer when they were younger. And she spoiled them rotten because she loved them so much. I really could just go on about how much she loved everybody. I don't think there was a person that she met that she didn't give love to. And I know that we love her extremely much. And death will not end that. Yeah, she'll be missed. But she won't be forgotten. We love you, Mom.
Debbie was a beloved family member, as we've heard from Ruth and from Joe, and she was also a beloved community member. So I would invite anybody who has a story or memory about Debbie, just raise your hand. I'll bring the microphone over, and we can share the stories from the community. No? Apparently somebody...
I'm Bridget Dekema, and I'm one of the prayer chain coordinators here at Faith, and I consider myself a good friend of Debbie's. And what a beautiful spirit she had. What I really, really admired her about is that she never felt sorry for herself, And if anybody could be in a miserable position because of health reasons, I personally thought it would be Debbie. But she would call me, or sometimes it was Beth that would call and tell me when Debbie was going in for another bronchoscopy. Boy, those were routine. And we'd get that prayer request out. And what I loved about her is they never failed to mention, pray for Joe and that close-up parking spot. Because if it wasn't there, it was harder on Joe. And she just always thought of everybody else.
Sonny Coble. I serve home communion to Debbie and Joe frequently when she couldn't attend church. And I never saw her that she wasn't smiling and so appreciative of the effort to bring communion to her. Special lady, as we've already heard. I left smiling as well. It was just a true pleasure to bring that to you, to her and you, Joe.
One here and then here. I'm Barbara Sifton, a relatively newcomer to faith, but I also served home communion to Debbie and Joe, and that's how I met Debbie. And she had such an elegance about her, even though she was homebound. And she was always concerned about us. And were we okay? Were we comfortable in her home? Even though she was obviously struggling sometimes to even breathe. And she was just such an inspiration. And what a dear, dear lady she was. Such a delight to get to know. And her faith was just so evident. And what an inspiration.
Hi, my name is Bill Brower, and I never met your mother. But I was assigned to be the contact when COVID came to visit our church. And so I would to call her. And I called her for 18 months every week. And I'll have to say that I came away with more blessings than I think she did. She was so faithful. And once in a great while, she said to me, you know, I'm really hurting. I think I'm grumpy today. she felt sorry for Joe, not for herself. And I admired her so much. Even though I never met her, I thought I got to know her because I got to see her love and her heart. She was a wonderful lady.
This is a little bit of a weird one. I'm Christopher Smithson, eldest grandson. And kind of from a growing up point of view, grandma trips were the staple of summer vacation. We'd get out of school and we'd start joking with friends and everything on our Xboxes and our PlayStations, and then it's, okay, well, we'll see you in like a month. We're going to Arizona. Arizona, what's there? Oh, it's just our grandma. Nothing special, right? Oh, I could not be more wrong. Oh, my gosh. Just didn't really see it at the time. Came down here, and she'd, all right, kids, let's hop in the car, let's hop in the van, we're going to church. Church. We didn't come down to Arizona for church. We came down to visit y'all. What are y'all talking about? What's this church thing, right? And I'm kidding. I'm kidding, by the way. We all went to church back home. But, it didn't actually hit me until 21 years. I'm across the entire Atlantic Ocean, away from everybody, and I'm in my room in the UK in 10 days of quarantine because this COVID thing is amazing. And I go, I don't have a lifeline. I don't have mom. I don't have dad. I don't have grandma. I don't have that connection anymore. And it was interesting to see how her love really was an anchor point for just day-to-day tasks that you wouldn't even think of. So I just want to say thank you all for coming, I guess.
Anyone else?
I'm Tyler Smithson, second eldest grandson, and one of the most vivid memories was it was probably about 15 years ago. She would come visit us, and I remember this because he got thrown into my bed because they would take the guest bedroom, and so me and my brothers, we would all have to share this one tiny room with two twin beds. And so we were all piled on top of each other. It was not pleasant until I remembered that grandma was next door, just a knock away. And then we got into so many fights about this one blanket. There was this one blanket that we would always fight about, and it was just like this, it smelled like grandma. It brought comfort, and I wish I could have taken it with me, but grandma always took it. And she had these little Eeyore cups that they were Winnie the Pooh cups, and they had Eeyore and Piglet and Pooh, and they were little travel cups, and it was for mouthwash and just drinking the water and everything. And it was just one of my favorite memories of grandma, just because it just brought so much comfort and passion into my life, and she was just an amazing woman. So like he said, thank you all for coming.
I think we can agree that Debbie Perry was a remarkable woman. Amen?
Amen.
And, you know, when you get to pastor remarkable people, it's really fun to be their pastor. And so when I think of Debbie, I think of someone who had unshakable faith. I mean, this woman lived it, breathed it, knew it in her very bones. And as we've heard all about the angels today, and I think we have to be reminded that the word angel means messenger of God. And, you know, I believe that we have earth angels as well, and Debbie was one of those amazing earth angels that was a messenger of God to all that she encountered. And frankly, it's not a formal title in the Presbyterian Church, but I want to name Debbie Archangel of Faith Presbyterian Church. I think it was a title she would appreciate. You know, who else pushes herself to join Zoom Bible study when she is barely gaining breath, right? Or then inspires the group with a wonderful anecdote and an insight to the scripture. The one who comes to Zoom coffee hour and gets her sister across the country to join her in it. You know, Debbie was that messenger of God to the people around her, no matter what her circumstances were. You know, we mentioned the love in her marriage to Joe. And Joe, we would be remiss if we did not note that you were an amazing caregiver to Debbie. And the reason that she was able to live and connect with people up to the very end was because you took such great care of her. And so, well done, faithful servant. She loved her children and adored her grandchildren and would talk about them and her as I didn't know about the phone and the address list, but it did seem like Debbie was always connected to everybody around her, and that she was a generous with her time and that listening ear for her family. And I don't know if this was something she had naturally or a gift that she developed over time, but it certainly was a gift to all who encountered her, even Bill Brower, who never met her and only talked on the phone. That's a wonderful story, Bill. And so, you know, in her later years, she had that faith that sustained her, and she confounded more than one medical specialist, right? Every time she'd go to the doctor, they would say, well, you know, this is probably the last time, and she goes, no. And she would challenge their predictions. And so in that way, Debbie was a true messenger of God, not only in what she said, but in how she lived her life. She knew her own voice, both physically and metaphorically. And so, you know, for us, as those who are left behind, we can receive that lesson of how to live a life even in the midst of suffering. Her strong faith reminds us that God is always about creating the new out of what has ended. And we may not see what that is today, but it will be revealed in time. The God who created heaven and earth, the God who led Moses and Miriam and the Hebrew slaves out of Egypt, the God who sent Jesus down to earth, the God who walked with the early church as they shared their faith and their way of life, that God is the same God who is present with us here today in all of our struggles and confusion, all of our challenges, in our sorrows, and in our joys. This same God walks with us into tomorrow, calls us into tomorrow, just ahead of us as we seek, each of us, how to be God's people on earth here today. And so as we celebrate the life of Debbie, the archangel of God, let us reflect on the nature of our own lives and how we might live them to the glory of God. Amen.
Thank you.
Thank you, Lisa, for that beautiful rendition. Let us pray. O God of grace, you have given us a new and living hope in Jesus Christ. And we thank you that by dying, Christ destroyed the power of death. And by rising from the grave, he opened the way to eternal life. Help us to remember that because he lives, we shall live also. That neither death nor life, nor things present nor things to come shall be able to separate us from your love in Christ Jesus our Lord. Amen. And let us pray the prayer that Jesus taught, saying together, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. The commendation is something, is a turning over. A turning over of Debbie as a person, as a spirit, as a human being into the hands of God. So listen as we do this now. Into your hands, O merciful Savior, we commend your servant Debbie. Acknowledge, we humbly pray, a sheep of your own fold, a lamb of your own flock, a sinner of your own redeeming. Receive her into the arms of your mercy and into the blessed rest of everlasting peace and into the glorious company of the saints in light. And let us say together, Amen. I invite you now, as you are able, to stand for our closing song, His Eye is on the Sparrow.
Thank you.
Friends, as we conclude this service, I invite you to remain in your pew until the family is able to exit and they can greet you in our entryway narthex. And now go with this blessing. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. May the Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. Amen.
Life can be so unkind. Everybody gotta go sometime. But I won't be sad when this life is done. 'Cause when it comes for me, I know I will be with the one who has given his life for me. And we'll be face to face as our hearts embrace. There'll be loving and laughter in the hereafter. I know I gotta die, but brother, what a way to go. Remember, this is not my home, so